Now, the coronavirus pandemic has put President Rodrigo Duterte's leadership to a test. But instead of focusing on the health crisis, Duterte signed a new anti-terrorism law and shut down the country's largest broadcast network. Let's discuss what the Duterte administration has done over the past year with Professor Julio Tehanqui. He's a professor of political science and international studies at De La Salle University, and you're now a visiting professor at the Kyoto University's Southeast Asian Studies Center, right?
Center, yes.
Thank you very much for joining us, sir.
Thank you for having me. Good morning.
Okay, first, let's talk about the optics of President Rodrigo Duterte's decision to be physically present at the Batasang Pambansa to deliver his second to the last State of the Nation address. Given the threat of the pandemic, does he have to be there physically? And what does it mean to be there at this time?
Well, this is a part of the tradition of the State of the Nation address. And it is also part of the symbolic nature of trying to project the powers of the presidency amidst this ongoing pandemic crisis.
But of course, more importantly, is how the government has actually been responding to the pandemic over the past few months, and we expect that to be tackled in great detail at the State of the Nation address. Now, from your perspective, what should actually be the messaging in the SONA this afternoon, coming from the president?
Well, actually, let's put it in its proper perspective. A presidency is actually either a sequel or a prequel to previous presidencies. And 4 years ago, this president offered a very compelling message of change, of bringing about change and trying to fulfill the failed promises of the previous presidencies and the previous so-called EDSA regime, you know, of based on liberal democracy. And a lot of people gave him the trust and confidence because of their own frustrations and anger towards the failures of previous administration to deliver on the promise of development and deepen democracy. And now he is already in his last 2 minutes, so to speak, in his administration, and he should focus his attention in delivering his promise of truly bringing about change, especially now in the middle of this pandemic. Now, the question is whether he will put into place the policies and the programs that will eventually bring about or bring back trust and confidence to not only for the people, but to the economy in order for us to navigate through the tumultuous coming events of the new normal.
What should be the tenor of the president's State of the Nation address later on? Of course, he should be truthful, but we know the president, as admitted by his allies, he could still afford to crack jokes even in the middle of a very serious health problem.
Well, yeah. The problem really is this is no time for inanities. No, it's time really to focus on what is important. And majority of our people are already distressed. They're already fearful. And it wouldn't help if your highest elected leader, your president, doesn't seem to take this crisis situation seriously. So this is no time for jokes. Enough of the political inanities. If this administration is serious about leaving a positive legacy for the Filipino people, it should devote all its energies and attention to simply two things, no? Saving lives and expanding livelihood. And in short, no, in Filipino, dalawa lang naman ang dapat tutukan ng Pangulo dito sa mga natitirang dalawang taon niya, no? Buhay at kabuhayan, no? Anything other than that is simply would be simply distractions to the task at hand.
Now, since the pandemic started a few months back, how has the president fared, based on your assessment, in terms of dealing with this very serious health crisis?
Well, essentially, no. Let's try to dissect the action not only of the president but his government and his administration in the past few months. No, in terms of the people's trust and support, in terms of legitimacy, the president has enjoyed the support of the people from the very beginning. No, ever since he was elected, he got a clear mandate from the Filipino people. His government is legitimate. He has maintained high popularity rating, and during the midterm elections, this support, this legitimacy coming from the people has been reaffirmed. And yet, it was apparent that he was at a good start. No, until the midterm, he was trying to implement his policies despite some of the controversial ones. Now, however, his government's chaotic response to this pandemic has resulted in a squandering of the political capital that has been given to him by the people. And right now, we are actually worse off than we were 5 months ago, unlike other countries that have actually succeeded in their effort to flatten the curve. So that's one, no? Legitimacy. Now, it all boils down actually to leadership, no? Leadership and competence, no? If we compare the President Duterte's action to other leaders, no? And if we compare other countries in their approach to addressing the pandemic, there are countries that are democratic that succeeded in addressing the pandemic, and there are other democratic countries that failed. There are other countries that are a bit authoritarian and they succeeded, like China and Vietnam, and there are a lot more authoritarian countries that fail. So it's not a question of regime type, whether you're democratic or authoritarian. It all boils down actually to leadership, no? And the competence of the people around that leader. So essentially, under this administration, the leadership has been found wanting, no? While the public and private health workers have done a tremendous job, no, addressing the pandemic as frontliners, the leadership, for example, of the Department of Health has really messed up the entire situation because of its hard-headed position not to do mass testing. You know? And of course, there's a huge list of what could have, should have, and would have, but we are where we are right now, Christian.
Now, that was quite a strong assessment, strong words that you use, that basically with the way the president has been handling this pandemic, he somehow squandered the political capital that he had been enjoying since 2016. Now, do you think this would be reflected in the surveys afterward?
Well, if it's any indication, the traditional social weather station survey of net optimists and pessimists and those who gained and lost have indicated a sharp decline from its previous numbers, no? From the previous numbers of this administration to where it is right now. So a lot more of our fellow Filipinos are less optimistic about the future, and they are definitely they have seen that they have lost in the past few months, no? In the recent months since last year. Definitely this will have an impact on the satisfaction towards this administration and the president. Now, and it will have an impact on the elections in 2022.
Like how?
Well, of course, we have seen in previous presidencies, this president, this administration has had the advantage of not diminishing its popular support right after the midterm elections, whereas all the post-Marcos presidents, from Cory Aquino all the way to Noynoy Aquino, suffered some decline, no, after the midterms, no. But this administration has not suffered that. But because of this pandemic, and we have seen this in the previous administration of Noynoy Aquino. Noynoy Aquino was personally popular, although his popularity was affected by the series of controversies after the midterms. he did not suffer, his government did not suffer the unpopularity, but rather it was his anointed, no? The anointed candidate of his administration that suffered in the presidential election. So I expect that there will be a similar pattern in which if the president and his administration do not handle this crisis in a very satisfactory manner, then it will have an impact on whoever he will anoint in the next round of elections.
Professor, what do you think has this pandemic, this crisis revealed more about the president's style of governance and leadership? I don't know if you would agree with this assessment that we know for a fact that President Duterte had been reliant on former military generals or even in the present crop of military men when it comes to handling certain situations. We saw that with the war on drugs in the Marawi crisis, with the way he was dealing with the communist insurgency, which of course heavily needs a military component. But in this case, we're now dealing with a health crisis. I don't know whether you agree with this observation that somehow it revealed even more that the president seems to be a one-trick pony when it comes to dealing with governance problems, that his default mode is to push the button regarding calling for a military approach, quote-unquote.
Oh, well, of course, Christian, we also have to take into consideration that President Duterte is a populist, no? And he is similar to the wave of populist leaders that have been elected in recent years in other countries, like, for example, Donald Trump in the United States and Jair Bolsonaro in Brazil, no? And given his populist rhetoric, no, there is a tendency really to go against the norms of liberal democracy, you know, the norms of liberalism, which is based on the respect for fundamental human rights, freedom of the individual, freedom of the press, media, etc. And of course, while he has the democratic mandate, he managed to get this the democratic mandate by weaving a narrative of a strong man, a strong arm, and largely military-based narrative, of even a law and order narrative. So remember, if we will remember, he ascended into power on a promise of a law and order platform. So and the people supported him on this. So he has this, from the outset, he has this already an authoritarian framework to begin with, in which he believes that all the problems of government and society can be approached through an iron fist policy.
And is it working now?
Well, the problem really is the manner by which this entire pandemic crisis has been framed, especially in media. No? It has been always framed as a war. It is not a war, it is a public health crisis. No? And if you always frame it in terms of being a war, definitely it will be much easier for some strongmen to actually treat it as war. And then in the case of the Philippines, it's really taking it to an extreme in which epidemiologists and virologists, instead of scientists, no, we mobilized our soldiers and our policemen in treating this virus. This is not the people are not the enemy, no, it's the virus, no, and we keep saying that over and over. And but if you have a militaristic approach, then it is not healthy even for the state of our democracy. So we are already facing a health crisis, and here we are diminishing the health of our democracy.
I'm going to squeeze in two questions as a final point here.
Yes.
How important is it for the president to be reassuring in his State of the Nation address later this afternoon, given the gravity of the problem? And number two, basically, do you think he still needs, he has his priorities right still? Because despite the pandemic, we know that he pushed hard to shut down ABS-CBN. He actually signed, made it his priority to enact a new anti-terrorism law. But still, we know that the bigger problem is the pandemic.
Right. Well, people are afraid. People are uncertain about their future. People do not know whether they will survive. And even if they survive, if they have any livelihood to further continue with their lives. No? What we need now is healing. What we need now is a calming voice. We do not need fear. We do not need threats. We do not need bullying. So if the president does really want to address the problem, which is the pandemic, no, he should be a unifying president, and he should set aside all his personal feelings and feelings of grudges, no, against his political opponents, and become the healing president that we need. And there is still time if he sets his vision and his plans and his program for the Filipino people, particularly in the coming years. He still has his 2 years to address the issue. But in short, ang kailangan lang po ng ating bansa ay buhay at kabuhayan. Yan lang po. Huwag na natin palawakin pa yung problema. No? Kung matutuunan ng pansin ng Pangulo itong dalawang problemang ito, mapapatawad siya ng sambayan ng Pilipino.
As you mentioned, Professor Tehangke, earlier, there's no time for political inanities. In short, no time to be petty. Well, thank you very much again for joining us on this program, Dean Julio Tehangke.
Maraming salamat.